Welcome to an intro video for square roots, cube roots, and nth roots. Let's take a look at a definition of nth roots. If we let a and b be real numbers, and n be an integer greater than or equal to 2, if we have an equation in the form of a equals b to the power of n, then b the base is an nth root of a. If n is equal to 2, the root is a square root. If n is equal to 3, the root is a cube root. If n equals 4, we have a fourth root, and so on. If we have equations in the form of a equals b to the power of n, as we see here as 4 equals 2 squared and 4 equals negative 2 squared, then the square roots of 4 are 2 and negative 2. And since 8 equals 2 to the power of 3, now n is 3, so we have the cube root of 8 is 2. And since 16 is equal to 2 to the power of 4, and 16 is equal to negative 2 to the power of 4, the fourth roots of 16 are 2 and negative 2. So what you might notice right away is some numbers have one nth root and others have two nth roots. And it really depends on whether n is even or odd. If a number does have two nth roots, that can be an issue. So we do have to have a way to distinguish between which nth root we want. And so that leads us to something called the principal nth root. The principal nth root of a is the nth root that has the same sign as a, and it is denoted in this way. We read this as the nth root of a, root a, or radical a. The positive integer n is called the index, and if n is equal to 2, we usually don't include the index. And the number a is called the radicand. So here's the idea behind the principal nth root. We know that 4 has two square roots, positive 2 and negative 2. But using this notation, the principal square root, it's only equal to positive 2. If we want the negative square root, we would use notation like this, where we have a negative to the left of the square root. And similarly, the fourth root of 16, written this way, is equal to 2, not negative 2. If we want the negative fourth root of 16, we would write it in this way. Let's go ahead and take a look at several examples of square roots and cube roots. So here we see several square roots where n is equal to 2. Remember it said before that if n is 2, they omit the index. I'm going to go ahead and write the index in for a few of these. Now the reason I wanted to do that, remember that the square root of 1 is the number squared that's equal to 1. So since we can write 1 as 1 squared, the square root of 1 is equal to 1. Since we can write the square root of 4 as 2 squared, the square root of 4 is equal to 2. What I want you to notice is that when the index is 2 and the exponent is 2, they basically undo each other because square rooting and squaring are opposite operations. And that's the idea we have to keep in mind when we simplify square roots. We're looking for perfect square factors, and if we can find those, it'll simplify very nicely for us. In the left column here, you can see that we want the negative square roots. The only difference here is we have a negative sign in front of all the radical signs. Let's go and take a look at the cube roots. The key to simplifying cube roots is trying to identify three equal factors or perfect cubes. What number cubed would give us 1? Well, 1 to the third equals 1, therefore the cube root of 1 is 1. The cube root of 8 is equal to the cube root of 2 cubed, therefore the cube root of 8 is equal to 2. So what we're trying to do here is make the number of factors match the index. And if we can do that, it simplifies perfectly, as we see here on the left. Notice on the right here, we have negative radicands. And that's OK as long as the index is odd, because remember the product of an odd number of negatives will still be negative. Notice we're using principal square root notation, where the radicand is negative. Therefore, in this case, our cube root is also negative. So you may want to pause the video and take a look at these, but this pattern that we're seeing is very important, not only in this video, but also the next video. Let's take a look at some examples. The square root of 36, we're trying to find two equal factors for 36, or some number squared that equals 36. Well, since 36 is equal to 6 times 6, which is equal to 6 squared, the square root of 36 would just be 6. Number 2, we want the negative square root of 81. We know that 81 is 9 times 9, which is the same as 9 squared. Therefore, this simplifies to negative 9. Again, I'm showing some work here. You can probably do some of these in your head, but the idea that we're developing is very important. especially for the next several videos. On number 3, we have a fraction, and that's not that big of an issue because we can take the square root of the numerator and the square of the denominator separately. And since 4 is equal to 2 times 2, 9 is equal to 3 times 3. Of course, this is 2 squared, so the square root of 2 squared would be 2. Square root of 3 squared would be 3. Now you'll notice on number 4 we have a cube root, so you have to be careful here. We don't want to get in a hurry and assume this is equal to 8. We want 3 equal factors that equal 64, or what number cubed will equal 64. 64 does equal 4 times 4 times 4, which is 4 to the third. Therefore, this equals 4. Here we have the fifth root of 32. If you made a factor tree for 32, it's actually 5 factors of 2, which is equal to 2 to the fifth. Therefore, the fifth root of 32 is equal to 2. On this one, we want the opposite of the cube root of negative 8. Negative 8 does have 3 equal factors of negative 2, so we'd have negative the cube root of negative 2 cubed. So we'd have a negative here, and this simplifies to negative 2, so the result is a positive 2. Okay, there's one more topic I want to talk about in this video. This first one is just a different form of what we've already discovered. If we take the nth root of a and raise it to the nth power, this will always equal a. The idea here is that finding the nth root of something and then raising it to the nth power are opposite operations, so these undo each other. And there's also one other consideration. If n is odd, this will just equal a. But if n is even, that means our radicand is positive. Therefore, this nth root must be positive. And to assure that it is, we would have the absolute value of a, not just a. Taking this idea one step further, we need the absolute value of any nth root with an odd exponent for which the index is even to assure that the nth root is positive. Let's take a look at a couple examples of this. So if we take the square root of x squared, this will just equal x, but this has to be a positive value, therefore this will be the absolute value of x, not just x. On number 2, we're looking for 3 equal factors of x to the ninth. Well, x to the ninth is the same as x to the third times x to the third times x to the third. So since this is really x to the power of 3 raised to the third power, this will simplify nicely to x cubed. Since the index is odd, there's no special considerations for this nth root. On number 3, we want 4 equal factors for x to the eighth, or what to the fourth power would equal x to the eighth. Well, we can write x to the eighth as x squared 4 times. So there are the 4 equal factors for x to the eighth, so this simplifies nicely to x squared. Now, x squared will always be positive, therefore we do not need the absolute value of x squared, even though the index is even. And the last one, we have the fourth root of y to the 12th. Again, we want 4 equal factors of y to the 12th. Well, that would be y to the third times itself 4 times. So this represents y to the third raised to the fourth power, which matches the index. So this simplifies nicely to y to the third, but this nth root must be positive because the index is even. Therefore, we have the absolute value of y to the third. Okay, I hope you found this video helpful. Next, we'll take a look at how to simplify radicals where they're not all perfect roots. Thank you for watching.